Okay. Let's go to the next topic. Guys, please settle. Let's move to the next topic now, which is on leading and lagging. We wanted to, but it didn't work. So I'll move to leading and lagging now. Now, let me first explain the concept on leading and lagging. Please settle down. Okay, now as far as leading and lagging is concerned, what happens is, when I have to pay something in a foreign, if I have a foreign currency liability or an asset, I have two approaches. One, I either pay the money immediately. If I pay the money immediately, I may pay a lower price because of currency may depreciate over the period. And when I pay a lower price, I may have some interest cost to be paid. So what leading and lagging basically is telling is whether to make the payment today or wait for the credit period and make the payment. Whether to realize the money today or wait and realize the money. That's the basic concept under leading and lagging. Basically, we are trying to decide whether I make the payment immediately or I wait and make the payment. That's the crux which we are going to see. Let's look at this question 2. Page 205, question 2. DEF Limited has imported goods to the extent of $1 crore. Payment terms are 60 days interest fee credit. For additional credit of 30 days, interest at the rate of 7.75% per annum will be charged. Banker has offered a 30-day loan at the rate of 9.5% per annum. Quote for Forex is as follows. Which one of the following options would be better? Pay the supplier on the 60th day and avail loan for 30 days. Avail the supplier's offer of 90 days credit. That is, we have an option to pay it in 60th day or 90th day. So we need to analyze which is better. Now, evaluation of payment. Split it into two. Pay in 60 days. Pay in 90 days. Evaluation of offer. Pay in 60 days and pay in 90 days. 60 days and 90 days. So if I pay it on 60th day, I'll make the payment by taking a loan. See, the option is pay the supplier on the 60th day and avail bank loan for 30 days or avail the supplier's offer of 90-day credit. I have to pay $1 crore. So if I pay in 60 days, $1 crore into 63.15, that's the rate which is there. Once you make this payment, plus you will have to pay interest at the rate of 9.5% because you will have to take a loan from your bank. Plus 9.5% interest per annum, you will proportionately calculate it for 30 days. We will have to do the calculation for 30 days. But my payment is going to be $1 crore into 63.15 plus, technically it is 63.15 crore into 9.5% into 1/12 or 30/365, whatever way you want to do. 1/12, I've done into 1/12. So this is my payment if I make the payment in 60 days. If I make the payment in 60 days, it's $1 crore into 63.15. Now, because it's INR and USD, it's easy. You will have a confusion whether to divide, multiply. So all of that can get added in any question. The confusion of this division, multiplication, bid, ask can come as part of any problem. $1 crore into 63.15 plus 63.15 crore into 9.5% into 1/12. This side, USD 1 crore plus the supplier is going to charge interest. He is saying, if you want, you can take extra 30-day credit at the rate of 7.75%. So plus 7.75% into 1 crore into 30/360. and this entire payment will be done at the rate of 63.45. The entire payment will be done at the rate of 63.45. Either you pay at the rate of 63.15 and pay interest at the rate of 9.5%, or take a supplier loan at 7.75% and pay it at 63.45. Whichever gives me lower amount, I'll opt that. Whichever option is having a lower outflow, I would end up opting that. In first option, I pay on the 60th day and take an INR loan. In the second option, I pay only on the 90th day. Now listen, how do I make the payment on the 90th day? I'm not worried about it, because 90th day you may take another loan, which will be here in both the sides also. In both the sides, you may have to take a loan after 90th day. I'm not worried about what happens after 90th day. See, as a concept, if you get this answer and these two are not comparable, because this is a 60th day figure and this is a 90th day figure. To make them comparable, I add this interest. So both the period should be the value at the end of day 90. Paying 63 crores in day 60 cannot be compared with paying 63.2 crores in day 90, which is lower or which is higher. You cannot compare, because you need it for the same time period. Both should be day 90 figure, or both should be day 60 figure. You'll have to ensure that both are for the same day. How do you do that is by adding interest or subtracting interest. That's the concept. If you have to bring them to the same time period, either do compounding, which is called adding interest, or do discounting, which is called deducting interest. You have to do one of the two and then bring it to the common base. So whichever is preferable, I'm not getting into the calculation part. You can complete it and then decide whichever option is beneficial. Any doubts in this? Any doubts on the calculation? Let's do this question, question 3. Now listen, G Limited has imported 5,000 bottles of shampoo at landed cost of US$20 each. Company has the choice for paying for the goods immediately or in 3 months' time. It has a clean overdraft limit where 14% rate of interest is charged. Pay in 3 months with interest at 10% and cover the forward risk. Settle now and pay interest on overdraft. You try to split this into two and do the calculation. Similar computation. It's going to be similar computation. Either you pay immediately or pay after 3 months. Here the analysis is whether to pay immediately or pay after 3 months. And if you have a doubt on bid ask, all that will come through that analysis. Known unknown component analysis will take you through that. Do a similar split and decide whether to pay on day 0 or day 90. Whether to pay on day 0 or day 60, day 90, you decide by comparing the two items. Day 0 or day 90. whichever part is giving a higher amount, sorry, lower amount, that you'll opt for. Will opt for paying it in 90th day. That will give me a lower outflow. I'll avail the supplier's offer of a 90-day credit. Avail the supplier's offer of a 90-day credit. 61,80,750. Guys, please. 61,80,750. Any doubts on this? Go through question one. Guys, please maintain silence. Go through question one. Okay, leave question one. It's similar to the earlier questions. I'll move to the next topic then. Leave question one. Leading and lagging is basically analysis of these two areas. Netting is something which I'm not doing. You can manage this at home. Basically, what happens in case of a netting transaction is when I have an inflow of a foreign currency as well as an outflow of foreign currency, I try to net it off and make a net payment. That's technically called as netting. I'll leave this. There's only one problem which you can manage. I'll move to now forward contract. In forward contract, we will have two parts to the forward contract. One is taking a forward contract and second is cancellation of a forward contract. I'll take you through first cancellation part. I'll take you through two proper problems on cancellation. There's a different format by which you get into the cancellation part. So I'll explain that. Once you understand that, balance things will automatically fall in place. Let's go through this question four. Let's go through question four. Guys, please maintain silence. A bank enters into a forward purchase covering the export bill for Swiss franc 1 lakh at rupees 32.4 due on 25th April and converted itself for same delivery in local interbank market. However, on 25th March, exporter sought for cancellation of the contract as the tenor of the bill is changed. In Singapore market, Swiss franc was quoted against, and in the interbank market, these are the rates. Calculate the cancellation charges payable by the customer if the exchange margin required is 0.10% on buying and selling. Now, any problem on Forex which involves a cancellation, anything will, for example, if there is something called as extension of a contract, it will involve a cancellation. If there's an early honor, again, it will involve a cancellation. So all transactions will involve a cancellation, except if you honor it on due date. Honoring it on due date is the only way of honoring a contract. All other approach will involve a cancellation. Now, to calculate cancellation profit or loss, write this: date, position, action, reference date, rate, date, position, action, reference date and rate, date, position, action, reference date and rate. Now, a bank enters into a forward purchase covering the export bill of Swiss franc 1 lakh at rupees 32.4 due on 25th April and converted itself for delivery in the local interbank market at 32.42. So some bank has entered into a contract with me to buy 1 lakh Swiss franc. I have entered into a contract to sell 1 lakh Swiss franc. A bank enters into a forward purchase contract. So bank enters into a purchase contract with me. I have entered into a sale contract. My cancellation charges is from a customer point of view. So our analysis will mostly be from a customer point of view when it comes to forward contract cancellation. Now listen, day zero, I don't know this date, on what date this was entered in. Listen for something. Day zero, original position, the action was, originally I entered into something called as a sell contract. I have entered into selling Swiss franc. I wanted to sell Swiss franc and the bank wanted to buy the Swiss franc. So my original contract was to sell Swiss franc. So date refers to the date on which the transaction is entered. Original position, that's the first contract, is called as original position. Action is, I entered into a contract of selling this. I had agreed on a date called as 25th April. I have agreed on a date, April 25. This is the date I have agreed on. And I have entered at 32.40. Suddenly I come on March 25th saying that I want a cancellation of the contract. Next is March 25. I come on March 25. Whenever I come back, opposite position. If you have to cancel, you'll have to take an opposite position, and opposite is buy. If you have originally entered into sell, you will have to enter into buy. Reference date will be same, April 25. The reference date is going to remain same, April 25. So I want to know what is the buying rate. Buying is bid rate. What is the bid rate on March 25 for April 25? This is how you'll read this table. What is the buying rate on March 25 for April 25? Technically, I want a 1 month forward rate. What is the buying rate on March 25 for April 25? So I am going to use this and this to calculate this, because I have to use the 1 month forward rate. I need the bid rate, buying rate. I need the bid rate. So my original contract was sell. Opposite contract is buy. I will do the rate calculation. Let's assume it comes out to be something like 31. Let's assume. If it's buy, it is negative. If it is sell, it is positive. And the format will automatically tell you whether you are making a profit or loss. In this case, there's a profit of 1.4 per Swiss franc. The profit is going to be 1.4 per Swiss franc. I'll have to calculate that rate. To calculate the rate, we'll have to use the basics. That is known component, unknown component. I'll have to do the calculation and come to the rate. But what I need is bid rate on March 25 for April 25. Bid rate on March 25 for April 25. That's how you'll read it. Bid rate on March 25 for April 25. So you will use this 1 month forward rates and give me something called as bid INR per Swiss franc. I had originally used some rate. Today, give me the bid rate for INR per Swiss franc to cancel it. Sorry. Ask from my point of view, I want the buy rate. The buy rate is ask INR per Swiss franc. We'll have to get this rate. Once we get this rate, I'll use that rate there, get the profit or loss, and then the cancellation charges would be paid by the customer. Now write this. Date, position, action, reference date and rate. Date, position, action, reference date and rate. Date, position, action, reference date and rate. Day zero, original position, sell, April 25, and agreed rate was 32.4. Then you come on March 25 saying that you will take an opposite contract. You come on March 25 saying that I want to cancel it. If you want to cancel it, first do the opposite position, which is a buy. I want on March 25, what is the buy rate? Buy rate is technically called as ask rate for April 25. On March 25, what is the buy rate for April 25? These two have to remain same. On March 25, what is the buy rate for April 25? So let's calculate that. Ask INR per Swiss franc. Ask INR per Swiss franc is equal to ask INR, the connecting currency is USD, INR per USD into USD by Swiss franc, INR by USD into USD per Swiss franc. It will go back to the same thing, the known unknown component, getting the formula from there, you get to the answer. Everywhere, you go back to the original basics and get to the answer. To get to a solution, you will have to again go back to only the basics. Do we have INR per USD directly given?
Yes, sir.
Which is? 49.42. I'm not sure how Institute has interpreted this. I have a doubt whether it is swap points or whether it is the rate as it is. We'll use rate as it is, but we will use it as the rate itself, 49.4200. You can write a note in exam saying that it is assumed that those given are not the points and that refers to the direct rate, 49.4200. Now listen, this exchange margin of 0.10%, Institute, whenever they use the word interbank market and other market, whenever these two markets are given, then that exchange margin is applied only on this quote and it's not applied on this quote. In Singapore market, for that quote, they don't apply that exchange margin. So I cannot wait and apply it in the end. What I will do is I'll add 0.1% at this place itself. I'll add 0.1%. If it was bid, I would have deducted 0.1% at this stage itself. I normally wait till the end and then apply it. But wherever interbank and Singapore 2 are given, Institute applies only for the interbank market. They've applied only for the interbank market. Technically, there's something called as a merchant rate and the customer rate. So in that concept, what they say is when a bank is dealing, for him, the exchange margin is not to be charged. So in that context, for your interbank, you charge it. But whenever there is some other market where you go and analyze, there you don't charge that exchange margin. From practical world point of view, you'll have clarity whether to charge or not. But from a problem point of view, this you'll have to take care. Do we have USD per Swiss franc in the question? So 1 by bid is 5150. Get this answer. 4 decimal answer. We will write, you will have to finally write a note saying that whatever those given in the question are assumed to be the quotes and not the points. Because if I assume it to be points, then I'll have to add them. 32.6531 INR per Swiss franc. Once I get this, I go back to this table. Minus 32.6531. And if it's negative, it is loss. Loss per Swiss franc. This is loss per Swiss franc. We have an exposure of loss for 1 lakh Swiss franc is 25310. Per Swiss franc is 0.2531. For 1 lakh Swiss franc, it is going to be 25310. I'll again use this format in some other question. You will find it easier to follow then. Whenever you will have to do a cancellation, profit or loss, you end up applying the data in this format and then get to the answer. Any doubts on this? Let's look at this question number 6. An importer requests his bank to extend the forward contract for $20,000, which is due for maturity on 30th October for a further period of 3 months. He agrees to pay the required margin money for such extension of the contract. contracted rate, this is the original rate. The US dollar quoted on 30/10/2010. Compute the cost to the importer in respect of extension, rate of new forward contract. Two things they've asked. One is rate of new forward contract and cost to the importer in respect of extension. Both will come in that format. Let's open that format. Date, position, action, reference date and rate. 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 I don't know on which date the contract was entered. Again, day zero. Original position. Original position. Day zero, original position. This analysis will entirely be from a customer point of view. Always it's from a customer point of view. The customer would be buying this dollars or selling this dollars?
Buying.
He is an importer. So original was buy. I agreed on for 30th October 2010. This is the date for which I have agreed the contract. 30th October 2010. And the rate at which we were agreed was -42.32. Why minus is? This is an outflow. -42.32. This is the rate we had agreed on. 42.32. Okay. Then this guy comes back on, maybe he comes on only the maturity date. He comes back on 30th October. So 30th October. If he wants to honor the commitment, great. Otherwise, first we'll have to, if he says extension, we'll have to first cancel it. Opposite position. Opposite position. Original position was to buy. Opposite position is to sell. Same date, 30th October 2010. Same date, 30th October 2010. So I want to know on 30th October 2010, what is the sell rate, bid rate? On 30th October 2010, what is the bid rate for 30th October 2010? How much? Okay, on this, I have to apply this. Now, there is some bit of confusion. Buying and selling rate, does it bankers buying rate and selling rate? Or is it customers buying and selling rate? Because it can be interpreted in both the ways. Because customers buying rate is called as ask rate and bankers buying rate is called as bid rate. So, this margin which is given, I have to make one assumption saying that the 0.00075, is it on bid or ask? Whatever assumption you take, you'll have to consistently follow for the next part of the question. So I assume this is on bid and this is on ask. That's my assumption. That is bankers buying rate and bankers selling rate. Bankers buying rate is bid rate, bankers selling rate is ask. When I do the second part of the question, when I calculate the new rate, there also I'll use the same logic. So, it is going to be 41.5 minus 0.075 percentage, 41.5 minus 0.075 percentage, minus 0.075 percentage, you get it as 41.47. 41.47. I can continue with the analysis or I stop at this stage and then I write. At this stage, I can say loss on cancellation. Loss on cancellation. I'll just put a total. Loss or profit, it could be either ways. Here it is a loss. Loss of 0.851 per US dollar. The loss is 0.851 per US dollar. 0.851 per US dollar. Loss is 0.851 per US dollar. Then on 30th October, he says, I'm going to enter into something which we call it as new position. He enters into a new contract now on 30th October, new position. The table will guide you to every solution, new position, buy, and now he is saying he wants it after 3 months. So he is going to enter for 31st January 2011. He wants to enter for 31st January 2011. Now I want to know on 30th October, what is 31st January rate? On 30th October, buy rate. Buy rate is basically ask. What is the ask rate on 30th October for 31st January? Ask rate on 30th October for 31st January. You can keep adding them. 41.52, add 0.93%. And on top of that, add another 0.2%. Add another 0.2%. Finally, it will become 41.99. Finally, it will become 41.99. 41.99. And I get something called as effective rate. What I end up indirectly paying is this. I end up paying 42.84 now. My effective rate is 42.84. I had a loss of 85 paise and my new position is at 41.99. My new position is at 41.99. So effectively I'll end up paying 42.84. The effective rate will not be asked in the exam. So the two parts to the question, what is loss on cancellation? 0.851 per dollar or into 20,000 you do. And new contract is at 41.99. The new contract is at 41.99. Any doubts on this? No, it's the same. I'm just going to explain something more. So now listen, this is not, in fact, the loss of the person. This will involve a cash outflow. But the real loss is, I wanted to originally do the contract at 42.32, but I've ended up doing now at 40. So my real loss is only 52 paise. How it's 52 paise is, you will pay 85 paise for cancellation, but you end up saving, when you do your new contract, no, the new contract is 33 paise lower. Originally it was at 42.32 and the new contract is only at 41.99. So in effect, my loss is, the actual loss is only 52 paise, but you have to, when you do a cancellation, pay 85 paise. And after 3 months, you will get this benefit because your new contract is at a lower rate now. So if I want to know what is the real loss is 42.84 compared with 42.32 and not this 85 paise. This will be a cash outflow, but this is not the loss. This is not the loss. My real loss is 42.84 in comparison with 42.32. So institute sometimes writes loss on cancellation. Sometimes they write effective loss. So you'll do both. Effective losses 42.84 minus of minus 42.32. So in effect 52 paise is my actual loss. The effective loss is only 52 paise. Though I pay 85 paise, in reality what do I lose is only 52 paise. All this I have done at a per dollar level. You will end up multiplying with 20,000 wherever it is needed and then get to the solution. Now, this format when you do, please make sure that you finally write down the answer because this will be difficult to follow for someone when you see it for the first time. So, if you are going to follow this format, you end up writing finally saying that point number one, cost to the importer in respect of extension of the forward contract is equal to cancellation loss of 0.851 per dollar or rupees 17,000 or effective loss is equal to so much. So you can end up writing both the answer. Rate of new forward contract is 41.99 because it's not easy to follow this format. So when someone sees it for the first time, they will not be in a position to follow. So you write your final answer properly. Any doubts on this? Just a minute. Okay, I'll come to a scenario where the customer does not come on the due date. So we'll have to do, see, in a practical world, on the due date, a cancellation has to happen. Either an honor will happen or a cancellation will happen. According to forward contract rules, you have to give a grace period of 15 days for the person to come. So in the next 15 days, the person may suddenly appear and saying that I want to honor the commitment. I want to cancel the commitment. So he can ask for any of those things. So if he comes after due date, what is to be done is what we'll see in this question number 8. Go through this question. Go through question 8. I'll explain this. An importer booked a forward contract with his bank on 10th April for USD 2 lakh due on 10th June. Bank covered itself at 64.28. So I got into a buying at 64.4. Bank got into buying at 64.28 and they wanted to make that profit of 12 paise. Exchange rates for dollar in the interbank market are, they've given spot USD and the rates are given. There is a repetition of rates for 2 months. This is how exam questions have been continuously. So I've just copied with the same numbers. Exchange margin, interest and outlay of funds. They've asked for these things. Now what has happened is this customer came on June 20, whereas the due date was June 10. On June 10 was the due date, but he suddenly appears on June 20 and asks for the contract to be either honored, cancelled. So what is to be done in that scenario? We'll see. Working note one. Evaluation from customer side. Working note one. Evaluation from customer side. From customer side. You can leave some 5 lines. Working note two. Evaluation from bank side. Evaluation from bank side. Okay, some 6-7 lines, leave 6-7 lines. Evaluation from customer side and evaluation from bank side. Date, position, action, reference date, rate. Same 5 columns for both. Date, position, action, reference date and rate. Date, position, action, reference date and rate. Date, position, action, reference date and rate. Now let's look at an importer booked a forward contract. Whatever is given in words, we'll have to convert this into table. Booked an forward contract with his bank on April 10. So April 10. Original position, April 10, original position. Importer is going to buy or sell? Buy. What was the date for which he entered? June 10. And it was agreed at 64.40. In a normal scenario, my next transaction should happen on June 10. He did not come on June 10. He has come on which day? June 20. So June 20. If he comes on the due date, he can honor his commitment. After that, if he says he wants to honor, still it will involve a cancellation. Unless you come on due date,
So any other time you come and say that you want to honor the commitment, it'll involve a cancellation. June 20 opposite position, sell.
Now we are in a very tricky scenario, that is I want to copy the same date, but problem is I cannot say that on June 20, what is the rate for June 10? You cannot go back and get a rate on June 20. What is the rate for June 10 is not possible. So because of that constraint, I copy the same date. That is, I'll use the spot rate for cancellation purpose. Ideally, these two should remain same. But unfortunately, you come on June 20 and then I say on June 20, what is the previous rate? Not possible to calculate. So on June 20, look at the question and tell me the sell rate. Sell is bid rate. What is the sell rate for June 20? On June 20, what is the sell rate for June 20? There is some exchange margin. Which one? June. So I'll use this. I don't know why the institute has interpreted this to be June 30. That is the end rate. Not sure why they have done, but every exam this happens. So they use this rate for the purpose of cancellation. This has been repeated. A similar problem would have come till now 5 times in exam, but all the exams they have ended up doing this only. They were given 2 rates, haven't found a reason why those 2 rates are there. So as of now, when I want to cancel, I'll take this first rate which is there. I'll take that rate and go ahead and do the cancellation. So what is the bid rate you see? 6163. Wait, you cannot write it that way. It has to be in multiples of 0025. So if it is 6163, the last 3 digits can either be last 2 digits, 25, 50 or 75. It has to be in multiples of 25. So either it's 25, 50, 75 or 00. So 63.6163 would be rounded off to 63.6175. It'll be rounded off to 63.6175. That is the 0.1%, no? After subtracting only. 63.68 minus 0.1%. 63.6175. I will do one thing, this I'll put minus, buy is minus. Now this 63.6175 is the answer to part one of the question, cancellation rate. 63.6175, all the answer will come in the table itself. 63.6175 is answer to part one of the question, which is your cancellation loss. The cancellation loss is 63.6175. Then on June, okay, let's first write this. Cancellation loss, all calculation at the per dollar level, we'll finally do it for all the $2 lakh. Cancellation loss 0.7825. Then on June 20, I'll enter into a new contract, new position. If it just does cancellation, then problem ends there. From a customer point of view, he wants to cancel and move out, that's all. New position, what is he asking for? He is asking for an extension to 10th August. So new position by August 10. Now listen, See, from a logic point of view, I can even take this rate or this rate depending on the contract maturity is what date. So unless I have data on exact maturity, it becomes very difficult to exactly write it. Institute has ended up taking the August rate. So August 10 means you end up taking the August rate. I don't know that August means August 30, August 15, August 10, August 5. You don't have any data on that. So whatever is the rate there in the month of August, go through that and tell me what is the buy rate. Go through that exchange margin, including the exchange margin, tell me what should be the rate. 64.3150
effective rate and effective loss.
We'll see what is exactly needed in the question, but my effective rate is the 65.0975. I end up effectively paying 65.0975. And my effective loss is 69 paise. Any doubts on this? Any doubts on this table? I'll answer what is required in the question after completing the table. Now what happened is, I entered into a contract, no? Because of me, bank also entered into a contract with someone else. We entered at the rate of 64.4, bank entered at the rate of 64.28. Now this analysis is this bank, whatever I'm going to do evaluation from bank side, they would have entered into a contract with some other bank. So originally bank and customer analysis is over. Now listen for some time. Original analysis is done. Now this bank, let's assume our bank is ICICI Bank. ICICI is now dealing with Citibank. Now with Citibank, what did I do is I entered into a contract to buy from them. Buy from them at the rate of 64.28. This is what the bank did. Why did the bank do this? Is they were confident that saying the customer would come, I'll buy from Citibank and sell it to the customer and make my 12 paise margin. That was the aim of the banker. So he did this. Suddenly on June 10, he sees customer is missing, but the ICICI cannot go to Citibank and say that I'm not going to honor the commitment. ICICI cannot go to Citibank and say that I am not honoring the commitment, because being it is easy to track a market, so they will have to honor their commitment. So what happens is on June 10, no, the rules state you cancel this contract and take the next available contract. Basically, you cancel the original contract on June 10. He cannot wait till June 20 and all, and take the next available contract. This is as per the rules. Why you take the next available contract is, in the next 15 days, suddenly the customer will appear and ask for the money. So if at all this customer is going to come in the next 15 days, so for a safety purpose, I have to take the next available contract. Now my entire analysis from bank's point of view, one bank dealing with some other bank, it's like this bank is a customer and there is another bank at the other side. Listen for some time. Opposite position. Sell on June 10. What is the sell rate for June 10? On June 10, no margin and all. Now on June 10, what is the sell rate for June 10? 60.880. It is, I am like a customer and I have a bank in the other side. So I did my original analysis, ABC Limited and ICICI. ABC was the customer, ICICI is the bank. Now ICICI is the customer and Citibank is the bank. So in this analysis, so this guy originally entered into a buy contract at the rate of 64.28. Suddenly on June 10, he is missing. When he is missing, I cancel it at 63.80. When I don't find this guy, I cancel it at 63.80. I end up paying a cancellation loss of 48 paise. This is not my real loss. I end up paying a cancellation loss of 48 paise. And on June 10, I enter into a new contract. I'll enter into a buy and I'll go to the next available contract, which is this. The next available contract is, maybe I technically assume this is June 30. I technically assume this to be June 30, the next available contract. I go ahead and take the next available contract, whatever is available. If it's available for June 20, let me take June 20. If it's available for June 15, let me take June 15. I take the next available contract. So I go ahead and take this. On June 10,
what is the buy rate for June 30? Look at the table and tell me. On June 10, what is the buy rate for June 30? 63.95. And this guy's effective loss is 0.15. This guy's effective loss is 0.15. If you understood these two tables, the problem is over. Now listen. Cancellation rate is this, 63.6175. Amount payable on $2 lakh is 0.7825 into $2 lakh. We'll answer this in some time. Swap loss is the effective loss of the banker, 15 paise. Swap loss is the effective loss of the banker because this will be recovered from me. He'll tell ke boss, you pay it. Interest on outlay of funds is, this is not my loss, but I have to pay this money. If I'm paying this money, I'll charge interest on this from the customer. This is not my loss, but I have to pay this. And whatever I pay for that, I'll charge an interest. New contract rate is 64.315. And my total cost is amount payable, swap loss. I'll add up everything and then get to this. So I have done one table from the customer point of view. Another table from the bank point of view. If you understand both the table, we'll answer the balance part of the question. Complete this table. Complete the table. Let me know if you have a doubt here. Between a bank and bank, there will not be margin, no? The exchange margin is only from a customer side. When a bank deals with a customer, he will charge an exchange margin. It can be, see, the practical world, you'll have clarity, but mostly in the real world, what happens is exchange margin may be applicable only to the end customer. But still, again, I'm repeating, it depends. Some question institute will take it, some question they may not take it. So that's a little bit of a tricky area. So if you have a doubt, you write a note, that's all. Wherever you have a confusion, you say it is assumed that exchange margin is available, applicable even for between a bank and a bank. Then you'll have to subtract here that 0.1. Any doubts on these two tables?
Yes.
Nee, so this has happened on June 10. Once the customer comes in, then they will take care of the next set of calculation. So I'm not. Nee, so on June 10, you cannot do till August 10 because you're not aware what the customer will need. I have to wait for the customer to come. Customer has to tell me what he needs. Guys, please maintain silence. Yeah. So it depends at this state, and again and cancellation can happen, but that analysis is not needed because when I pay this effective loss, it kind of takes care for me. So I have covered myself till whatever date is applicable. Then that date will come. I will cancel then and then take a new contract. So I'm not worried about what happens beyond that. Any doubts in these two tables? Yeah.
So on June 10th, when we take from
banks,
can we take July's forward?
So ideally, that's what I said. No, I'm not sure. How do I interpret this table? If I interpret June 30, June 30 is closest to July 10, so I take that. If I interpret this as July 10 itself, then I should have taken with this. So the rates are for which date is, we are not sure. So institute just took the next available contract and then they did the analysis. Ideally speaking, I can even take my new contract with this if it is the July 10 rate. So which is July 10, I don't know. Whether it is the June 30 to be taken or the July column to be taken. That is something which is a little confusing in the question. Any doubts in these two tables? Any doubts? Now write point number one. Cancellation rate equal to 63.6175. Next, amount payable on $2 lakh equal to amount payable on $2 lakh equal to 0.7825 into 2 lakhs. 0.7825 into 2 lakhs. 0.7825 into 2 lakhs. Swap loss is equal to 0.15 into 2 lakhs. Swap loss is equal to 0.15 into 2 lakhs. 0.15 into 2 lakhs. Interest on outlay of funds equal to 0.48 into 2 lakhs. Interest on outlay of funds equal to 0.48 into 2 lakhs into the number of days the customer is not available. So if he's not available for 10 days, he'll have to charge 10 day interest, because once he comes, he will pay this amount. 0.48 into 2 lakhs into 10 by 365, the rate is what, interest rate 12%. 0.48 into 2 lakhs into 12% into 10 by 365, 10 day interest. You'll have to charge interest for 10 days. The interest is to be charged for 10 days. 0.48 into 2 lakhs into 12% into 10 by 365. New contract rate is equal to 64.315. Everything is there in the table. 64.315. New contract rate is equal to 64.315. New contract rate is equal to 64.315, and total cost is point number 2, 3, 4. This three things put together, total cost is 2 plus 3 plus 4, swap loss, amount payable, interest on outlay of funds, all three put together.
Mm-hmm. Any doubts in this? Clear? I'll proceed to question 5 then. As far as forward contract is concerned, if you are clear on this format, you will be in a position to easily calculate the cancellation gain or loss. The format will guide you to the answer. Like we have a format in M&A, this format I extensively use it for derivatives as well as forward contract. In derivatives also we use the same format to get the profit or loss. Here also I end up using the same format: date, position, action, reference date and rate. Date refers to the date on which the contract is entered. Position is either an original position or an opposite position or a new position. Action could be a buy or a sell. The date, reference date could be something. So this table, when you read it, it will say on April 10, what is the buy rate for June 10? So it's easier for you to then search in the question. On June 20, what is the buy rate for August 10? So it will clearly tell you whether to look at 1 month forward rate or a 2 month forward rate or a 3 month forward rate. It will also tell you whether to look for a bid rate or a ask rate. And it will also help you in getting the profit or loss. It will, if you get a positive answer, it is profit. If you get a negative answer, it will turn out to be loss. Any doubts on this? Then I have to take the 15 days ka rates. They will give me another table, which will be June 25. I look at those rates. If rates remain same, if this table which you see, on June 25 it is similar, then the answer would remain same, except that interest will be for 15 days.
What is the
Yeah, in fact, the contract is already lapsed. That original lapse has already happened. But as per the foreign exchange rules, in fact, in practical world, this is not going to happen. Because as a banker, I'll call the customer and get to know what is he going to do. Because it's easy to talk to the customer and get to know. And if customer is unavailable at that point of time, maybe then I will not be in a position to even trace him afterwards. So either I contact him on that day, get to know what he wants to do. Because this is more of bookish concept, not something which is going to be used in a practical world. Because either the customer is available on that day or not available. So if he's available, he'll tell you, boss, cancel it. Because it's basically looking like that I'm not even in a position to reach the customer. If I reach the customer, he'll tell you on June 10, please extend it. Then on June 10 itself, we'll do a cancellation. He extends it. I also extend my contract. So if the customer does it on June 10 itself, no, whatever loss I have with ICICI Bank or Citibank, that the customer will not pay. The customer is not going to pay. Indirectly, what will happen is if you have a loss with the other bank, you will have a profit with your customer. The rates will move in such a way that if you have loss there, you will have profit here and you kind of set it off against each other. But if the customer is not available, I'm in an uncertainty. So that is where I recover the money from the customer. Let's do this question 5. Go through this. Go through question 5. Okay. Now, I have imported goods worth $7 lakh. This amount is payable after 3 months. The company has also exported goods for $4 lakh 50. This is receivable in some 2 months. A forward contract is already taken. Market rates are given. The company wants to cover the risk and it has two options: cover payables in the forward market, lag the receivables by 1 month and cover the risk only for net amount. That is, I have a $7 lakh payable in 3 months. I have a $4 lakh 50 thousand receivable in 2 months. One option is I go ahead and cover the entire amount in the forex market. Second option is I tell my customer, don't pay me at the end of second month. You wait for one more month and then I cover only for the net amount. That is, maybe even my customer pays it, I'll keep it in the foreign exchange account. I don't convert it. And at the end of third month, I use it to pay my supplier and I cover only for 2,50,000. If I'm going with the second option, I will have to cancel this contract, which is already taken at 48.9. I had already taken a contract at the rate of 48.9. So if I go with option one, I will not have any cancellation. At the end of second month, money will come. At the end of third month, a payable will happen. But if I go ahead with second option, if I lag my receivables, then I have to cancel the forward contract. Working note one, evaluation of option one. Evaluation of option one. Evaluation of option one. Evaluation of option one. Particulars calculation amount. Particulars calculation amount. Particulars calculation amount. Evaluation of option one. Particulars calculation amount. To cover payables in the forward market is the scenario. So point number one, receive 2,00,000 USD, sorry, 2,50,000, 4,50,000 USD in month two and convert. Receive 4,50,000 US dollar in month two and convert. 4.5 into, the rate is already entered in. I'll receive this money. I'll receive this money in month two. Pay $7,00,000 in month three. Pay $7,00,000 in month three. For this, I would have already taken a forward contract. If I originally take a forward contract, at what rate will I enter for 3 months later on? It is points. Points means you will have to add them. They are in points. This is also points. So if they give points, you will have to add them. So spot is 48.50/70. 2 months and 3 months points are given. Points are in ascending order, I'll add them. Points are in descending order, we'll deduct them. So this number is going to be 7 into 49.15. Okay, now listen. When some cash flow happens in month 2 and some happens in month 3, you cannot add them. Finance doesn't allow it to be added because cash flows happen at different points. You can bring the month 2 to month 3 by adding interest. Or from month 3, you can take everything back to month 2 by deducting interest. So something has to be done. I cannot add a month 2 and month 3 cash flow. So I'm going to take everything to month 3 in the end. My final answer is going to be month 3 answer because I'll compare it with the month 3 answer of the second option. So I'll say interest saving on 220.05 lakhs. I receive this money. When I receive this money, I'll save interest for 1 month. Interest saving on 220.05 lakhs for 1 month. Interest saving on 220.05 lakhs for 1 month. we are calculating outflow, so okay, let me write it this. This is an inflow, interest saving 2.205. Interest saving on 220.05 lakhs. I receive that money of 220.05 lakhs. Either I create a FD and earn interest, or I use it to close my loan and save interest. In either ways, I have an inflow of money. Net outflow. Net outflow. Net outflow. 121.795 lakhs. Any doubts in this? Then evaluation of option 2. Evaluation of option 2. Evaluation of option 2. In option 2, what will happen is you will receive 7, you will pay $7 lakh, you're going to receive 4 lakh 50. So in effect, we'll say pay $2,50,000 in month 3. That's all. This is the only thing I have to pay, $2,50,000 in month 3. $2,50,000 in month 3, 2.5 lakhs into 49.15. This is an outflow. Now, apart from this, there is going to be this forex gain or loss. I want you to calculate if you cancel that forward contract, what will happen? Because you're going to lag the receivables. So, point number 2 is forex. Forward cancellation gain or loss. You do the table and try. If you have understood that calculation, you will be in a position to calculate this easily. Forward contract cancellation gain or loss. Today itself, I'll cancel it because I anyway know that I'm going to lag the receivables. So I know I'm going to lag the receivable. Put it in that format, date, position, action, reference, date and rate. You will get to know the cancellation gain or loss. You will get to know the cancellation gain or loss. Today itself. Today itself, I know. No, I'm not going to honor the commitment.
Today, what date?
Day zero. Let's call it as day zero. That's all.
But today only I
would have
entered.
No, I've already entered in this. Why will I enter now? For receivable amount, a forward contract is already taken. So it could have been done maybe some 1 month back, 2 months back, 3 months back. We don't know when was that taken. Try to do it. Try to put it in that format. Date, position, action, reference, date and rate. You should get to the answer. You should be in a position to get to the answer. Selling, no? You are 4,50,000 goods exported for receivable.
So receivable
is importer is buying, receivable is selling. Try to put it in that format. Thank you. original date, original position. I don't know what date he entered in. So originally he wanted to sell. It could have been for, I don't know the period also, but as of now I get to know that in 2 months this is going to mature. Now it is today. We are not writing a date. Today, opposite position, buy. What is the buy rate today for month 2? You look at the data. What is the buy rate today for month 2? Buy rate today for month 2? 48.7 plus 30 points, 49 minus 49, and you have a loss. Loss on cancellation. So it's very simple. What is the buy rate today for month 2? If you are able to write the correct information in this table, it will guide you to the answer easily. It will guide you to the solution. Loss on cancellation is 0.1. And overall losses into 4.5 lakhs. And this is my overall outflow. Sorry, okay. This is day zero, interest on loss. If I have to take it to month three, if I have to take this to month three, I'll have to consider, see, basic rule of finances, any cash flow which happen at different points of time, they cannot be added. My forex loss happens today. My payment happens at the end of third month. I cannot add them. I have to bring them to an equal common date. It could be day 0, month 3, month 6. Normally, we bring it to the maturity date. So, interest on losses 0.45 into 12% into 3 by 12. 3 months interest, and this is your total outflow. Total outflow. When are you paying this? I'm cancelling it today. I cannot wait for 2 months, no. If I have to wait for 2 months, I need to know the rates after 2 months. That I cannot decide today. Today I am deciding whether to lag the receivables or take only a forward contract for the payables portion. When you analyze today, you have to decide today itself whether to cancel or not. So this is with an assumption that I cancel it today. That is why we wrote here. If you see, I have written today here. The action is happening on today. So I have decided to cancel it today. Finally, we will go ahead with a scenario which is option 1, yeah. So, concept of finance is either consider opportunity cost or real cost. If you consider opportunity cost here, then you don't consider interest saving this side. Because I have considered interest saving here. If I consider interest saving this place, then I don't consider opportunity cost here. Otherwise, it will become double counting. You will end up double counting that. Either you go with real cash flows or you go with an opportunity cost principle. But if you are saying I'll consider opportunity cost in option 2, which is right, then in option 1 there's no concept of saving. Because then it will become double counting. You will unnecessarily penalize so much on option 1 and give the benefit in option 2. So I'll finally go ahead with option 1, which has a lower outflow. Any doubts in this? Any doubts in this? I'll do one problem on money market hedge and then I'll move to something called as comprehensive hedging on the forex side. So let's do one problem on money market hedge. Any doubts till now? Any doubts on this? Let's do money market hedge one problem. Okay, now listen, listen guys, as far as money market hedge is concerned, the rule is I have to match an asset with a liability or a liability with an asset. That is, when I prepare my balance sheet, if I have a receivable, against that receivable I should have a loan also.
if I have a payable, against that payable, I should also have a deposit, so that there is no foreign exchange risk for me. If I have a receivable, I also have a loan. If forex moves up, receivable will also go up, loan will also go up, no effect. If forex comes down, receivable will also come down, loan will also come down, no effect. Same is the case with payable. If you have a payable, create a deposit. So if you have a liability, create a matching asset. If you have an asset, create a matching liability. That's the principle. So if at all I have, let's assume I need to pay $5 lakh after 12 months, then what I need to do today is, to pay $5 lakh, I'll have to create a deposit of $4,80,000. How do I create a deposit of $4,80,000? Is by taking an INR loan. By taking a INR loan. So indirectly what will happen is, let the forex move up or come down, this maturity of $4,80,000 will take care of the loan repayment. What will I have to pay is, I'll have to pay interest on the INR loan. So indirectly I convert a forex liability into a INR liability by doing this. We'll end up converting a forex liability into a INR liability. So if I have an asset, I'll create a liability. If I have a liability, I'll create an asset. That's the principle. Let's look at question number one. An exporter is a UK based company. Invoice amount is $3,50,000. Credit period is 3 months. Exchange rates, rates of interest in money market. Compute and show how a money market hedge can be put in place. Working note 1, creation of money market hedge. Creation of money market hedge. Creation of money market hedge. Particulars calculation amount. Particulars calculation amount. Creation of money market hedge. Particulars calculation amount. Day zero. We have a receivable or a payable?
Receivable.
If I have a receivable, against this receivable, I'll create a loan. I'll create a loan in such a way that it matures to USD 3,50,000. It has to mature to USD 3,50,000. Point number one, take USD loan at, what's the borrowing rate in US?
9%.
At 9% for 3 months. Take USD loan at 9% for 3 months. 3,50,000 divided by 2.25% divided by 1.0225. I'll take this loan, 3,42,298.29. After taking the loan, I'll convert this into my home currency. Convert USD into GBP at spot rate. Convert USD into GBP at spot rate. If you have a doubt whether to use bid rate, ask rate, you will have to go through known and unknown component. or you will have to then also division multiplication. Wherever there's a confusion, you will have to take the detailed route. As of now, I'll tell it 3,42,298.29. It is division. Divided by today's rate. 5,905 divided by 1.5905.
whether it is bid rate, ask rate, if you have a confusion, you will have to do that detailed analysis. It'll take a little bit of time, so I'm directly giving you the number. This will be the GBP. Deposit GBP 215, 214.27 at 5% for 3 months. Same amount. I'll create a deposit at 5% for 3 months. I need not take any forward contract, nothing. I'll just do these three things. There's no concept of taking a forward contract and all. Then you will get to day 90. You will go to day 90. You will go to day 90. You will go to day 90. On day 90, first thing which will happen is redeem USD deposit. Collect money from customer. Collect money from customer and pay USD loan. Collect money from customer and pay USD loan. You will collect 3,50,000 and pay off 3,50,000. In that process, you don't have any other liability. Collect 350 and pay 350. Collect money from customer and pay USD loan. Collect money from customer and pay USD loan. Money from customer and pay USD loan. Redeem GBP deposit along with interest. This will be my final proceeds. This will be the final proceeds. 215 into 1.0125. This is what I'll collect. I'm not doing the forward contract analysis. Basically, this is how money market hedge will work. You will end up collecting some 217,904.45. You will end up collecting 217,904.45. Any doubts in this? Clear? I'll have to again take a break of 10 minutes. We'll take a break of 10 minutes and then have the last session after this. I'll take a break of 10 minutes again.